Welcome to ITU Telecom World 2017 from Busan in the Republic of Korea. I'm very pleased to be joined in the studio today by Dean Bubley, who's the founder and director of Disruptive Analysis. Dean, welcome to the studio.
Thank you.
Now, I'd like to start off by talking about digital smart transformation. It's the theme here at ITU Telecom World. What does it mean to you, if anything?
Right. I have to say, I'm not a big fan of some of the buzzwords. So you won't usually hear me talking about the word digital, and you won't hear me using the word transformation. But I'm moderating a panel tomorrow on reinventing telcos, which I think is a bit more descriptive. And I think that it's a technology thing, and I think we'll talk about that in a minute, whether it's 5G or fiber or whatever. But it's also a cultural and process and organizational thing. And I think that one of the issues I see in the telecoms industry is getting around the move from being a sort of a traditional business that sells phone calls and access to one that is more like a software company, where products are developed, they're conceived, they're prototyped, they iterate and they change over time. Sometimes they fail, sometimes they get replaced. Rather than the sort of top-down view that the telecoms world traditionally had, is like, here are some standards and one or two services, now everyone go and sell them. This is more like the other way around, of see what works, see what customers, whether it's consumers or businesses, want, improve them, the products, occasionally they'll have issues, and eventually they may become standardized. So it's really transforming from top down to bottom up.
Now, you're moderating, as you said, you're moderating a session this week on reinventing telcos. Mm. Why have telcos, in your opinion, taken so long to react?
I think there's a couple of things. One is they are institutionally hamstrung by some of the ways in which they are both set up, their existing sunk investments. In some cases, they have a profile of employees that is geared towards engineers and lawyers, shall we say, rather than designers and marketers and mavericks. And so I think that there needs to be a sort of a bit of injection of risk-taking in some cases, but also a new set of skills, a new set of people that are more comfortable with less analysis and less defined propositions up front, and also perhaps different attitudes to their network access versus their services business. The other issue is, and I'm going to be probably quite controversial here, I think that some of the industry organizations need to change as well. And so I think the structure of and processes of whether it's ITU or GSMA or 3GPP, while they're changing, I'm not sure they're changing fast enough. And I think that, you know, sort of having 1 year or multi-year cycles for things in a world where products change on a weekly basis obviously brings challenges. The other side to this that I think that is the root cause of some of the problems with telcos is they talk about innovation, but they don't do any R&D. I think probably the operator with the largest R&D budget is NTT in Japan, which has, I don't know, $3 billion. And then there's a number of other large operators that do R&D at decent levels, whether it's AT&T or BT or Orange or SKT here in Korea. But you compare that with the budgets that are put either by the big network vendors. You know, I was with Huawei recently. I think it's $10 billion. $11 billion. Samsung, I think, is 13, and sort of all Apple, Facebook, Google. They all do $5, $6, $8, $10 billion R&D. So that means that any one of those does more R&D than all of the operators on the planet put together. And it's unsurprising then that where the innovation and where the new services and revenue comes from. And I think that mindset of putting money into research and creating things needs to change, rather than just relying on a couple of standards bodies or the vendors to invent new stuff for them.
And in terms of 5G, obviously, Internet of Things and AI, how are these going to impact on telcos?
Well, I could probably talk to a day on each of those, but I think that the interesting question is how they impact on society and how they affect telcos. IoT is the trickiest one in a way, because I think it's going to be massively important, but I think a lot of the implementations will have relatively little to do with the telecoms industry, because they will be done by industrial companies. Yeah, a telecom company isn't going to be hosting the software to stop robots colliding inside a car manufacturing plant. Yeah, important, or similarly to sort of do lift, you know, predictive maintenance on elevators. So I think that it's going to be quite hard for operators to get out of the connectivity part of the puzzle, which is a fairly small percentage, unless they develop deep domain expertise. And what I expect to see is operators have maybe one, two, three, four areas where they put money into. So you might find, I don't know, Telstra with mining, or Orange with healthcare, or you know, Vodafone with vehicles, or something like that. But they're not going to be able to cover everything. 5G. 5G is clearly having a huge effect on the general consciousness of mobile broadband and also IoT connectivity. I have some different views on 5G to a lot of people. I think that we're going to start seeing it initially for fixed access, probably here and also in the US. And a couple of other places for the last 100-200 meters from a fiber node. I think that we will then see it in sort of hotspots in urban areas for sort of more faster, better mobile broadband for probably smartphones predominantly. And that won't be different, because you'll have small islands of 5G in an ocean of 4G, so there's no such thing there as a 5G business model. It just doesn't make sense. I think the other use cases of around IoT, whether that's massive IoT or low latency, I think they are currently being overhyped, and I think they will be later to market than people expect. I think the massive IoT, frankly, operators are only just rolling out NB-IoT, which is the 4G version, so they're not going to rip it out 2 years later with a 5G one. So that's going to be pushed back. The other side, although we might get sort of 4.5, 4.9G and sort of bits and pieces of that. The ultra-low latency stuff is really interesting, whether that's for drones or headsets or AR headsets or something. The problem there is the commercials. Let's say, let's be generous and say 1% of end devices need that low latency. Is that enough to essentially put the compromises on everything else, add cost and complexity? And yeah, unless you're going to charge $1,000 a month ARPU for a VR headset, I don't know if the numbers stack up. I think there will be some important point use cases. So you can imagine for public safety or for maybe private. I think, and there's a really interesting trend here about telcos, or is it private 4G and 5G networks, where you could perhaps have a private network on a manufacturing plant. So I think that's a possibility. What was the other one? AI. AI, again, has many, many touch points for telcos, whether that's in terms of the internal operations, running the network, optimizing paths through the network or maintenance or whatever, planning of upgrades. There's some interesting stuff around the customer interface, perhaps looking to make it easier for people to do customer service and either self-service or have a bot of some sort. And then there's the sort of the AI which relates to extracting data from perhaps unexpected sources. I saw an interesting thing yesterday from KT saying that they've realized that some of the patterns they see in the light on their optical fibers could indicate, give early warning of earthquakes or other natural, because the way it diffracts inside the fiber. And that's a really sort of off-beam use case, but it's the sort of thing that if you have AI that's looking for anomalies to normal behavior, you might throw things up like that. You also have the poacher as well as the gamekeeper, and the risk here is that the end user's AI might be smarter than the network's AI. So if my AI is trying to manage the amount I spend, you know, it sort of pre-caches data over Wi-Fi when it knows it's cheap. It sort of negotiates my tariff on my behalf. As a customer, maybe I have an artificial intelligent mobile purchasing bot of my own, which actually drives a harder bargain than I could.
Absolutely. Well, no, we all need those, I think. And just really, I mean, in terms of the what have you seen and what have you heard here at ITU Telecom World that's particularly stimulated you or struck your imagination?
Okay. I was on a panel, or I was in a panel session yesterday that I was listening to on what seems like a quite dry topic, but is actually important, which is on spectrum management. And there seemed to be, if not complete consensus, but at least, you know, grudging acceptance or enthusiasm for shared spectrum. And normally, you either have wireless bands which are dedicated, which is, for example, for cellular or for satellite or broadcast, or you have unlicensed, such as Wi-Fi. And there's an interesting middle ground, because increasingly it's getting very difficult to offer new slices of dedicated spectrum for mobile broadband, because pretty much every bit of spectrum, there's something there already, even if it's not used very much. And to actually clear and replace, you know, even an isolated example of, I don't know, point-to-point microwave, is actually getting very complicated. So there's new ways of dividing up spectrum so that that existing user, which could be the military for naval radar or something like that, which isn't going to move, to leave them protected, but other people can use the spectrum either in places or at times when it's free. And I think we're moving towards a world where that is going to be used for mobile broadband. It may be used to build on-premise enterprise networks using wireless for IoT. And I thought the panel was more positive towards that than I might have expected at this event.
Now, it's been a few years that since you've been here, but I know that obviously you've taken the time out of your busy schedule to be here. I just wanted to find out, why is this event important? What makes it stand out in your calendar?
Well, firstly, it's obviously a slightly different audience to some of the events I go to, and I do everything from deep technical events to policy events, and this event is, you do have a fairly sort of government and policy slant to it, but also it's interesting because, particularly this being in South Korea, there are out on the show floor an awful lot of interesting startups. And you know, one of the things I want to try and do today is grab an hour to wander around and sort of look at, I've seen everything from virtual reality headsets to a toy dolls, which are actually robots for kids, to navigation devices for container ships. I probably want to sort of drill into some of these a bit more. I think the sessions are interesting as well because they are more international than some events. And so you do have a lot of people from parts of the world with different attitudes to telecoms and also to policy and governance. And sometimes it throws up some of the tensions as well as some of the agreements. And I think it's important to understand where that is, because I think that's an issue for network developers and also analysts and consultants such as myself.
Dean Bubley, thank you very much for being with us in the studio today, and we wish you the very best for the rest of the event and for the future.
Great, thank you.
Thank you. Cheers.